So the other thing I wanted to talk about was sting nematode, and I'll try and get through this just a little bit quicker. So background again on sting nematode is it was first recognized as a pest. It seems strange now, the amount of damage it does, but we really didn't recognize it as much of a pest on Florida citrus in all the years leading up to the freezes. But once the freezes happened in the mid-80s, and you had successive freezes and lots and lots and lots of replanting, we realized that it's a really bad problem on young trees. It's a bad enough problem on older trees, but it's a serious, serious problem on young trees. All right, and that's when the research began with sting nematode. And now that, of course, HLB is causing everybody to replant on a frequent basis, sting nematodes have reemerged as a really major problem on these young trees. It's a really large nematode. I had a picture of it. I can go backwards. This is a male and a female nematode. You can see here the stylet of this nematode. I know you don't look at these all the time, but this is a huge, long stylet that they stick into the tip of the growing root right as it's beginning to grow. They put it right into that apical meristem and kill it. So you end up with these stubby root symptoms that you see down here on the bottom slide. I think a lot of you have probably seen these symptoms. One of the things that the nematode does that other nematodes don't necessarily do is when the soil dries near the surface, it moves downward very quickly. And so it's found deep in the soil very frequently, and it'll keep the tree roots from growing down and establishing deeper in the soil. As you see right here, you see how it's just, you've got a fairly normal root mass here, but boy, you get down a little bit in the soil and they're just not growing anymore, and that's a huge problem. So how do we manage sting nematode? These are the four types of management that we talk about in terms of nematode management. They're really listed in the order of importance. You definitely, whenever you can, you want to keep the nematodes out of your grove using sanitation, certified rootstocks and stuff. Resistance tolerance, you want to definitely, if resistance is available, you want to be able to employ that as well. And then cultural practices, and finally, things that you have to spend more money on, like chemical control. So what about sanitation? The nematode rootstock certification and program is one of the most valuable things that was ever done in this citrus industry. It's incredibly important for managing things like citrus nematode, burrowing nematode, coffee lesion nematode. You have far fewer groves infested with these things than any other industry in the world because of the certification program. But sting nematode was never on that because sting nematode is everywhere. It doesn't have restricted host ranges like some of these others. It's found all through the state in sandy soils, and so it didn't really make sense to be on the program. And now that all citrus is produced in containers, it's really a moot point. As far as resistance and tolerance, there is none really known for the sting nematode, whether it's in other crops or in citrus. These are some of the rootstocks that have been tested. These are some of the more conventional rootstocks up until the present time, until some of these new USDA and UF varieties are getting released. And there's just absolutely no resistance in any of these rootstocks. But now with the release of a lot of these new rootstocks and with the increased recognition of this nematode as a problem, there has been funding to begin screening again some of the newly available stuff. These are some of the USDA rootstocks in tanks that have sting nematodes or don't have sting nematodes. And the evaluations are just now beginning, but they are looking kind of interesting. This is showing you a rootstock that was either not infested with a nematode or infested with a nematode, and you can see the kind of reduction in the root system that's occurring in these tanks. As opposed to other varieties here, that this is non-infested and this is infested, that are looking relatively tolerant to the damage that this nematode can cause. And if you look at it in terms of the weights of the roots that are on these plants, you can see that the amount of roots in an infested plant compared to the non-infested for some of these is really, really different than for others. And the thing that's really, and this is like, this is our visual damage rating, and this is what the root densities are showing us as far as their tolerance to this nematode. And some of these more tolerant ones have the same parentage, all right? So these were tetraploids that were made in a non-sexual method, protoplast fusion, that were then sexually combined to form some of these other lines that are being produced right now out of the University of Florida. And these ones that are in red all have virtually the same parentage. So that's really encouraging that there may be something in the genetics of these things that are making them more tolerant to the damage from sting nematode. And we'll see as we try and validate that in the field. Some of these, of course, are already planted out in trials, and some of those trials have sting nematode, and we've begun evaluating those. Cultural practices. There are two cover crop plants that we've looked at that do offer some promise, because your citrus trees, as their roots grow out into the middles, are being attacked by populations that are growing by all the weeds out there in the middles. It has a really wide host range, this nematode. And so if we could eliminate the wild, you know, plants that are growing out there that are growing these populations and replace them with cover crops that will not support them, there would be less pressure on these trees as their roots grow out into the middles. This is sun hemp, and it's a very good crop to reduce the nematode, and it could be used in a rotation or in a fallow situation. So when the grove is pulled and until the next one is put in place, you could plant sun hemp and reduce your sting nematode population for the time when you're going to replant citrus. This is showing you where we had sun hemp here, how many sting nematodes we were finding compared to out here in the middles that are not, that are just simply mowed. It's too tall of a plant. It's too difficult to manage culturally if you were to use it as a middle management tool. So in that situation, you could be looking at perennial peanut. Perennial peanut is doing just as good a job. Of course, it's a low-growing, decumbent thing. Both of these plants create nitrogen for the... Yeah, they're fixing nitrogen, so they're beneficial from that standpoint as well. But the perennial peanut, we've been really happy to see that this is where we have the population of sting nematodes, where we have the perennial peanut growing in trials that are being supported by CRDF, and this is in the weed middles here, you can see. And these blue, for this one it's sting nematodes, and this blue line is just showing where we had some weed incursion in there. We don't have really good stands of perennial peanut necessarily, but we're still getting pretty good control. Another nematode that's similar to sting, I'm not talking about it today other than here, is dagger nematode. It's becoming more of a problem on citrus. And you can see that dagger nematode is also suppressed very nicely by perennial peanut compared to this mixed situation or where we have just weeds in the middles. So it's giving good control of both of those big ectoparasitic nematodes that are feeding right there at the root tip and causing the tips not to grow any. And we've got a lot of roots out there too. You can take a look at, see what it does to the root system. So what about chemical control? There is really no biological products available to manage nematodes at this point that are effective. For chemical control, however, there have been a lot of new nematicides developed in the last few years. That's a real relief, because there hadn't been for decades and decades. The new nematicides are extremely safe to use compared to the old organophosphates and carbamates that we use to control nematodes. So they're very promising from that standpoint. They're good nematicides, they're very effective, but using them in sprinkler irrigation under citrus trees is still something that needs to be looked at, because they're mostly used in row crops at the moment. And so again, the CRDF has funded work to do this. This is a project that we've just finished up after 3 years. And essentially, we've put out four new nematicides and two of the traditional nematicides, Temic and Vidate, to see their effects on these trees that have greening and that have sting nematode. And essentially what we've seen is that, first, I want to show you that on the untreated trees, the control trees that we have in the experiment, come on. Initially, they started off with the most roots, just by chance. The ones that we chose just happened to be bigger, all right? And they started off with more roots, but you can see that very quickly a lot of the products began to increase the root mass compared to these controls, until here at the end, the Vidate treatment is about threefold difference as far as the root mass on the trees. So they are having the desired effect, some of them at least. This is the nematode reduction that you can see. And again, the untreated trees started off relatively few nematodes compared to the ones that we treated. But eventually, we end up with some of these treated trees being far fewer nematodes. They are getting good control. This is just the overall control that we got over the entire time. You can see that some of these worked reasonably well, others not so well compared to the control rate here. And if we look at the effects of these nematicides on the harvest, whether or not they look as though it's going to be profitable to use them, we're rather disappointed in the sense that the trees are producing, they're dropping their fruit essentially. And they're producing so few fruit at 4 years that it really, really looks like it's going to be difficult to recover any costs of nematode management. The thing that we did see is that we really couldn't see an effect of nematicides unless we considered the initial size of the tree. I told you that the control trees, the untreated trees, were bigger at the beginning. And they remained bigger. As they were bigger in the beginning, there was more yield at the end than when they were small at the beginning. But here you can see that the nematode is reducing the amount of fruit in all situations. And so it's a highly significant effect if we could get these trees to hold on to their fruit. But they're not holding on to their fruit right now. And because of that, it really doesn't seem that practical to be managing the nematodes. One of the similar question that we've got right now, and again CRDF is funding, is if we do have the trees covered to prevent them from getting greening for the first few years, are they going to respond better to the nematicides, and could that be profitable? And I just show you that we've got a trial in right now. Essentially, we just have four treatments here replicated a lot of times in this block. And at the end of this, we'll know just how much better. They're already growing quite a bit better with the covers on them than without the covers. But we'll know whether or not they're responding to the nematicides differentially as well. So ideally, what we're looking at is to manage this nematode with a combination of rootstock resistance, possibly cover crops, possibly the use of nematicides, but an IPM approach. And we'll see how that goes. So again, I imagine I'm out of time. All right, thank you very much.